And a very good morning to you, Grenada, and the rest of the world. It's the second day of May. Happy belated May Day greetings, and welcome to today's edition of Good Day Grenada. Folks, boy, you know, recently we've been turning things upside down quite a bit, and this morning's going to be no exception. This morning, believe it or not, we're actually going to begin with a segment that we usually end our Thursday morning segment with. Rather than waiting too much longer, we're going to be hearing from Mr. Alan Bajinski, who is very early this morning. And roll your sleeves up, because this morning this man's going to be talking about mosquitoes. I don't know what the heck mosquitoes have done to him, but he's going to be talking about mosquitoes. Let me take a look and see if he's there. Hey, there he is. There he is. Say good morning, Mr. Bajinski, and how are you, sir?
Good morning. I am well. I have survived mosquito bites.
You have survived mosquito bites, and you're very early this morning. Alan, thank you very much for joining us. I know that you've got other things to do, but you did find the time to be with us, and we do appreciate that. So keep us in suspense no longer, sir. Tell us about these mosquitoes. Is it like, are they like the kites that have been flying overhead?
Huh? Well, that is part of it. But, you know, there is a fairly widespread opinion that we need better health services in our nation.
No.
As a matter of fact, the person who currently occupies the ministerial position,
yeah,
is well documented as having claimed that we need better health services. But that was before he was elevated to his current exalted position. I don't know if he has forgotten about the need. But nevertheless, as citizens, we need to provide support. And I think that the ministry needs the support of the population with regard to the provision of information. And there are departments within every ministry where the citizen can interact. And so a phone call was made to the vector control unit,
all right,
which is the department of the Ministry of Health. And the query that was raised went along the lines of, is there a mosquito problem in Monjalu? And the response that came from the individual who answered the phone was, well, I don't know. I'm not living up there. No. The reality is that perhaps the inquiry might have been better phrased,
yeah,
along the lines of, have you had any reports of unusual mosquito infestation in Monjalu? So I suppose the inquiry, not having been properly phrased, met with the response that I have just reported.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But nevertheless, I am sure that there must be many other individuals who have had a similar experience when interacting with government departments, because the individuals who are entrusted with the responsibility of answering phones, the first point of contact between the citizen and the service provider, more often than not, is a person who perhaps has not had the benefit of proper training, has not had the benefit of perhaps a full education. And certainly, it leads to the unfortunate conclusion, and I mean no disrespect, but nevertheless, it leads to the unfortunate conclusion that every time you try to call a government department, it's an Imani who is answering the phone. It's very sad. Now, the consequence of further inquiries is that an examination was made by very pleasant, very engaging members of the unit, in contrast to the person who answered the phone, frankly. And we learn some things. One is that, yes, it is the dry season, supposedly, and we all understand that you need to make sure there's no standing water on your premises. But then what became apparent, having established that there's no standing water on my premises or the neighbor's premises, it was then, I don't know if revealed is the correct word, but restated, because I knew it before, that mosquitoes have a range of a radius of about 400 meters. So unless you actually are in a position to do a thorough search of everything within a 400 meter radius, it's very difficult to find the source of your mosquito problem. Mm-hmm. Now, as I say, the members of the team who came around and inspected did in fact find a possible source of infestation in a property which is within the 400 meter radius, but has been unoccupied for a period of 3 or 4 months. Prior to that it was occupied by individuals of not of local nationality, and many of them were living in the property. I don't know if that has anything to do with the fact that the septic tank was broken, and swarms of mosquitoes breed in unsealed septic tanks. I didn't know this, so I'm sharing this with you and the other viewers and listeners. Please, if you have a septic tank, make sure, and it is, and the cover, the lid is above ground. Make sure that during the dry season, when the earth shifts, cracks may develop in the surface of the tank, and you need to plaster the tank. If you are in the fortunate circumstances, as I am, where I actually have grass growing over the lid, then you don't have a problem. So the mosquitoes can't swarm from the septic tank. But you will understand that having discovered perhaps the source or the origin of the infestation, I was even more pleased when the members of the vector control team said that they happened to have some cement with them. And in the absence of the owner or the occupant, they were able to seal the cracks. So we're waiting for 5 to 7 days to see whether there will be a reduction in the infestation. Now, I say 5 to 7 days because naturally, we consider very often mosquitoes to be just a nuisance that we live with until such time as the Minister of Health comes on and says, oh, well, we had chikungunya, now we have to be careful with Zika. But there's some other things, you know. Apart from malaria, yellow fever, West Nile virus, dengue, mosquitoes, which are responsible for spreading these diseases. Apparently, mosquitoes kill more people worldwide than any other animal.
Absolutely.
Over 700 thousand people die from mosquito-borne infections every year. So it seems to me that we ought to be taking this thing more seriously and not just waiting for the minister and the ministry. Every now and again, they tell us about Zika and chikungunya. No, we need to be looking at septic tanks. Now, this business about mosquitoes, okay, so they're a little pest, fine. But you know, on reflection, when you look at and listen to social media and radio programs, and you hear pests who call in, and they seem to have one common buzz, which is support the unsupportable, defend the indefensible. It doesn't matter what failings are attributed to whatever quarter, they come out from their septic tanks and they start buzzing. Always in support. Always in support. They seem to be unable, absolutely unable, to find anything wrong with anything that is taking place. These bloodsuckers. These mosquitoes. I don't know where we are going to find this septic tank that they're all swarming from and seal it well and permanently.
I bet you're hoping that John here and Kariku says mosquitoes. He calls them mozzies, by the way. Mosquitoes have a 21-day life cycle, maybe. So you're hoping
That's a female. That's a female, not a male. What happens is that the male lasts from about 5 to 7 days, depending on the species. But what is interesting is that when they start swarming, the females fly into the swarm for mating. And maybe we're seeing some of that as well. These females flying into the swarm.
And I bet you wish that they only had a 21-day or
three-day cycle. A short life cycle. Yeah.
Martin Carmichael Simon. Where is Martin? I think Martin is in London. Yeah, Martin's in London, and he says, the mosquitoes these days are GM. And I guess, I wonder if he's referring to genetically modified.
Yeah, I believe I did see something once that certain intelligence agencies are genetically modifying mosquitoes. I'm sure there's a nefarious purpose. Earlier this week, we saw the entertaining spectacle of the Norwegians retrieving a beluga whale, which had a harness on it. And the conclusion was that the Russians are employing whales as military assets.
I see.
So why not mosquitoes?
Mr. B, while you were speaking a little while ago, I was making some notes about some things that you were saying. And you talked about what it's like to, you know, to call the ministry and the sort of response that you get. When you said that, AB, my eyes just lit up because, no, seriously, hold on. Can you imagine calling a ministry? Hi, good morning. May I speak to the minister, please? You want to talk to him? Hell no. I called because I want to blow a kiss to him. Can you imagine a staff member being asked? Now, I have absolutely no proof that this was an Imani, okay? No proof whatsoever. But that's the type of thing one has to put up with these days. And let me ask you this. I'm sure you heard the Minister of Health saying some time ago that he was going to set up a chat forum so that people could comment on the healthcare system.
I missed that.
Oh, you missed that one. Yeah, well, apparently a promise was made at, I think it might have been a post-cabinet briefing, that he was going to set up this forum, you know, to give the people a chance to vent and let them have their thoughts about the healthcare system. And I haven't seen that yet. Mm-hmm. And I also want to share another little story with you. You mentioned the mosquitoes breeding, right? In the septic tanks. And you know septic tanks create something which we breathe in, okay? Now, a few years ago, Alan, I was admitted to hospital. Actually, this is right after I returned to Grenada 30-something years ago. And I had what's called a pulmonary embolism, which is a blood clot in your lung, and that made it difficult for you to breathe.
Right.
Okay. Well, one of our local newspapers did an article about the fact that George Grant, the manager of Radio Grenada, has been admitted to hospital. And he has a problem breathing.
You're not serious. B-R-E-E-D-I-N-G?
Yes, Mr. Bijinski. Would I lie to you, sir? Yes, sir.
Well, it's a quote from, I suppose, all of the local newspapers. I'm at a lost, L-O-S-T, to understand what they were getting at.
Yeah. My love life has never recovered since then.
Well, I can imagine.
Alan, we're in pretty bad shape. Anyhow, but a lot of it is funny, I'm sure, humorous. I mean, you get a chance. It gives you fodder, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Because, I mean, if we can't laugh, what would we be doing?
Exactly. Stress. Pele Darbo says, you called to speak, not to talk. I'm not sure what Pele is referring to.
Speak with the minister, I suppose.
Oh. You called to speak, not to talk. Yeah, okay. Okay, Pele. Call to speak to the minister. Yeah, that's what Alan...
Though having said that, while you might wish to speak with the minister, I think what the minister really needs is a good talking to.
Will he listen too?
Well, that depends on how busy he is these days.
Okay.
I did see a suggestion that his salary should be docked for every day he's not at work.
Yes, I have seen that. Yeah. All right, Alan. Listen, I know that you're scooting this morning.
You gotta run.
Were you in St. David's yesterday?
He has to think about it. No. I was checking. No, I was in St. David's on Tuesday, so I saw the preparations being made. I assume at the last, so just playing field, if that's what where it was.
Okay. Have you heard of anything exciting that came out of yesterday's celebrations?
No, I deliberately tuned out.
Oh.
In fact, yesterday I was looking at the other disgraceful spectacle of these mosquitoes swarming out of a septic tank in the U.S. Senate. These Republicans, they defy comprehension, really.
You talk about tuning out. That's one of the things I have done. I have to confess, I sort of tuned out of American politics a lot, so I rely on you to come in here and vent on it.
And tell you the latest about the buffoonery.
Yes. Somebody sent me a video over the past week of the president's car and how adept they are, you know, at handling any emergencies the president may encounter as he drives around the city. And when I saw that, I don't know if I sent that video to you, but when I saw that, I thought about you because it's some incredible work.
Driving in reverse at high speed.
You saw that?
Yeah,
you saw that. Okay, Martin Carmichael Simon here in London is asking whether you guys listened to the Minister of Labor yesterday. No, you know, Martin, I'm going to try and find some time today. I have a very big program coming up later on tonight, but I'm going to try and find some time to watch that today. And Alan, you obviously didn't hear the Minister of Labor yesterday. What I can tell you is that he spoke for about 18 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I
would assume that, like every Labor Day, there were fireworks. Thanks a lot, AB. You go do what you have to do.
Bye.
Thank you. Take care, man. Mr. Alan Bijinski. Yes, sirree. There he goes. Thank you so much, Alan. Folks, it's 20 minutes after 9 o'clock, and I would you believe I went right into Alan as the first segment this morning without even giving you the rundown for this morning's program. And I hope that you guys are going to sit right there because I've got some more very interesting segments coming up. One, after the break, we're going to be talking about racial discrimination in the United States. And I'm going to explain to you in just a wee bit why I'm taking on the United States this morning. Two, there is a very interesting piece from a gentleman named O'Malley Yeshitla. And he was addressing the Oxford Union earlier on this year and made some references to what's going on between the United States and Venezuela. And I thought I'd really share that with you this morning as well. The third piece that I want to show to you, more fond memories out of Grenada. This time, the carronage. Guess who? Gentleman who was with us earlier this week. None other than Mr. Anthony D. Riggs. But right now, let's take our first little break. We'll come back.
Are you equipped to take a closer look behind the numbers? The Caribbean Institute of Forensic Accounting can help you build your professional skills to audit and investigate fraud, waste, and abuse. Through the Forensic Certified Public Accountants FCPA program, you gain qualification to conduct forensic audits and investigations globally. Earn international recognition and designation as a Forensic Certified Public Accountant from the Forensic CPA Society of the USA. Certificate courses run May to November 2019 in Grenada at the Grenada National Stadium. To register, contact us at info@cfa-edu.com or 868-224-3478.
I'm always on the move. Training, traveling, competing. So it's good to know I have Coop Bank in the palm of my hand.
Introducing e-banking, one of many customer convenience services from Grenada Cooperative Bank. And there's more to come.
It's swift, simple, and secure.
Welcome home.
My name is Jennifer James, and I've been making confectionaries for the past 7 years. Growing up as a little girl, I always wanted to make these little things. Fudge, sugar cake, tamarind ball, these little things. I read something actually, and it said that tamarind itself is very good because it eliminates fat from the liver. You get the mature tamarind and you crack it, you shell it out. I would add a little baking soda, some spices. I would leave it to rest probably for about 2 hours and then add my sugar and just start kneading. I usually knead it hard enough so that I can roll it. When I finish roll it, I will paste it with the actual white or brown sugar. And you have a nice tamarind ball. I have been providing food fair with tamarind ball about 6 years now. I started producing tamarind ball to sell for the school children. I thought I could advance somewhere. So I went to food fair and I asked one of the sales persons there to if they would be interested in selling my tamarind ball. And she told me yes. She told me I'm to bring 20 packets to start with. It was really a joy for me because I wanted to extend on my little business. My name is Jennifer James and I work with the food fair to provide you with tamarind balls.
Okie dokie, folks. Let me say a quick hello to those of you online this morning. Margaret's there, Martin Carmichael, Benedict Cador, Peter Bishop, Rachel John, Fitzroy Adams. John is there. Margaret says, I was waiting patiently for the mosquito punchline. Alan Priceless. Yeah, girl, he sure is. Veronica Sandy is sending blessings to everyone. Pele is there with us this morning. Kipling is also there with us this morning. Kipling says, it's ironic. The only time Grenadians are surprised is when the government does something worthwhile. When it's all bad, all you can hear is, we are accustomed to that. Okay. Folks, I am an avid collector of videos. Last night, I spent some time going through my collection. Since we do not have a national report for you today, I decided to share a couple of those videos with you. By the way, because yesterday was an a public holiday, there was no GIS report, okay? Really, these are self-explanatory. But suffice to say, I picked the first one, which is about racial discrimination in the United States, because of the conversation which we had yesterday morning with a clinical psychologist in the U.S., Jillian Scott. She spoke with us about the discrimination being faced by many who choose to wear hairstyles which are usually different from the norm. Things like weaves, braids, locks, you name it. Well, for those of you who live in the U.S., you will be very much aware of another type of discrimination, which you are about to hear so eloquently enunciated. It's self-explanatory. Listen to this.
It was the official policy of the United States government until 1968. In my lifetime and the lifetime of 90 senators who serve today, the official policy of this government was to help white people buy homes and to deny that help to black people. And because the federal government had set the standard, private lenders enthusiastically followed in Washington's lead. Homes are the way that millions of working families build some economic security. They pay down a mortgage and own an asset that, over time, often appreciates. A home serves as security to fund other ventures, to start a small business, or to send a youngster to college. And if grandma and grandpa can hang on to the home and get it paid off, they can often pass along an asset that boosts the finances of the next generation and the one after that. And that's exactly what white people have done for generations, but not black people. Systematically, over many decades, government policies that encouraged mortgage companies to lend only to white borrowers cut the legs out from underneath minority families trying to build some family wealth. And the result has been exactly what you'd predict. It's contributed to a staggering gap of wealth between white communities and communities of color today. Here's one statistic from Massachusetts. According to the Boston Globe, the median net worth of white families living in Boston is $247,500. And the median net worth for a black family is $8. That's something that all Americans, regardless of race, should be ashamed of. When I was traveling around the country in the aftermath of the financial crisis, it became clear to me that the crash had made the problem worse. Subprime lenders who had peddled mortgages full of tricks and traps had specifically targeted minority borrowers. That meant that during the Great Recession, a huge number of minority borrowers lost their homes. And when rising home prices helped white Americans regain some financial security, communities of color, with their lower homeownership rates and their higher foreclosure rates, were often left behind. Again, just one example. According to Pew, between 2010 and 2013, the median wealth of white households grew by 2.4%, but the wealth of Hispanic households in that same time fell by 14.3%, and the wealth of African American households fell by 33.7%. Mortgage discrimination didn't end in the 1960s when formal redlining policies were abolished. It didn't end with the tightening of mortgage rules following the financial crisis. Lending discrimination is still alive and well in America in 2018. According to a new report that just came out from the Center for Investigative Reporting and Reveal, in 2015 and 2016, nearly two-thirds of mortgage lenders denied loans for people of color at higher rates than for white people. This problem affects both big lenders and small lenders, and it's nationwide. Minority borrowers were more likely to be denied a mortgage than white borrowers with the same income in 61 different cities across America. And how do we know that? Because of HMDA data. That's how we can see how much black families were charged for a mortgage, or how often Latino families were denied a chance to take out a mortgage. And we can compare those numbers with white borrowers who have the same incomes and same credit scores. But we can't do that if the data are missing. It is impossible to detect and fight mortgage discrimination without HMDA data. The bill on the banking on the floor of the Senate says that 85% of banks will no longer be required to report HMDA data, including the borrower's credit score and age, the loan's points, fees, and interest rate, and the property value. 85%. These data are essential to figuring out whether the borrower got a fair deal or not. If this bill passes, there will be entire communities where there won't be enough data to figure out whether borrowers are getting ripped off. Entire communities where it will be impossible to monitor whether people are getting cheated because of their race or gender. Entire communities where federal and state regulators won't be able to bring cases, and independent groups like Reveal won't be able to hold these groups accountable. Sure, banks will save a little money by not having to fill out the HMDA data, but when communities of color are once again left behind, there will be no way to prove it. And that's why civil rights groups around the country have spoken up against this bill. The Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights said, and I'm quoting, "Exempting the overwhelming majority of our nation's banks and credit unions from an expanded HMDA requirement that would better enable federal regulators, state attorneys general, fair housing advocates, and others to identify and address discriminatory and predatory mortgage practices is unwise." The Urban League and the National Community Reinvestment Coalition wrote in a newspaper column that the bill, quote, would be a giant step backwards for the public and national groups who use this data to ensure that banks treat all borrowers equally. And according to the NAACP, the bill, quote, would devastate our attempts to determine and potentially rectify racially discriminatory lending or loan approval patterns at play. This is about basic fairness. HMDA data is an investment we should be making to make sure that all qualified Americans have the same chance to buy a home. Throughout our history, Washington has always fallen short of that goal. Gutting HMDA allows our country and our government to ignore discrimination, letting history repeat itself. Communities of color will pay the price if this Congress makes the same mistakes again. It isn't too late. We can stop this bill from becoming law.
Well, no need to tell you that that video went viral. And I played it in keeping with the discussion that we had yesterday. And the fact that so many of you who listen to the programs on Grenada Broadcast are in the United States. So much of what you just heard, I'm sure many of you are already aware of. But worth repeating. Pilgrims, we're going to take another little break here. And we're going to come back. Remember, no GIS report this morning, no national report this morning. Hence the reason we've got the time to bring you all these little goodies. Let's take a little break, and we'll come back with the Oxford Union.
Boyo, they got fly with kite now. The wind picking up.
I'm coming. Kaim, what you doing?
Fly my kite.
Yeah, but not here. You can't fly kite near power lines, boy.
Why not? The wind good.
Because mommy say kite threads conduct electricity.
Yeah, kite. He's right. If your kite gets stuck in power lines, it can cause power outages, or even worse, it can get shot.
Come, let's go and fly them in the pasture.
Yeah, that makes sense. Kite threads conduct electricity. Do not fly kites near overhead power lines. This can lead to electric shocks and power outages. If your kite gets stuck in power lines, do not try to retrieve it. Release it and call Grenlec. Always fly kites in open areas. Keep your kites far away from roots. And remember, always clean up after yourself.
Grenlec, energizing our Grenada.
Are you equipped to take a closer look behind the numbers? The Caribbean Institute of Forensic Accounting can help you build your professional skills to audit and investigate fraud, waste, and abuse. Through the Forensic Certified Public Accountants FCPA program, you gain qualification to conduct forensic audits and investigations globally. Earn international recognition and designation as a Forensic Certified Public Accountant from the Forensic CPA Society of the USA. Certificate courses run May to November 2019 in Grenada at the Grenada National Stadium. To register, contact us at info@cifa-edu.com or 868-224-3478.
Juve chocolates, cocoa nibs, and cocoa balls from Diamond Estate Grenada are now available at Amazon.com, Amazon.ca, Amazon.co.uk, and GrenadaMarket.com. Try the sensational touch of nutmeg and a touch of ginger chocolates, 75% dark and rich, 100% pure cocoa, and their 60% dark and sweet chocolate bars today. Amazon Prime members enjoy free shipping on these orders in the USA, Canada, and Europe. GrenadaMarket.com. When you can't come to the island, the products of the island will come to you.
Folks, the Oxford Union is the world's most prestigious debating society, with an unparalleled reputation for bringing in international guests and speakers to Oxford. Since 1823, the Union has been promoting debate and discussion, not just at Oxford University, but across the globe. O'Malley Yeshaitla, born Joseph Waller, is the founder of the Uhuru Movement, an African internationalist organization based in St. Petersburg, Florida, with members throughout the world. In February of this year, Mr. Yeshaitla spoke at the Oxford Union and addressed the situation in Venezuela. Check this out.
now look to Amoli Yeshitela to continue the case for the proposition.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, I have only recently come here from the United States of America. And that being the case, I cannot stand before this august body without prefacing my statement in defense of closer unity of Africa, without stating first my unconditional solidarity with President Maduro and the government and people of Venezuela, who are currently under attack, savage attack, by the declining world hegemon of the United States. I think it's absolutely necessary to say that, coming from that country, and especially looking at the fact that the United States travels the world preening, presenting itself as the guardian of democracy and the rights of the peoples around the world, where the reality is that Africans who are colonized in the United States represent at least half of the largest prison population in the world. There are more Africans in prison in the United States than there are people in Djibouti or in Equatorial Guinea. And so we find it very difficult, also recognizing that by their own estimates, it would take 228 years for the income of Africans colonized in the United States to equal that of the colonial white population. So it is absolutely necessary for me to stand here today before you expressing total opposition to the United States government terroristic actions against the people of Venezuela with an attempt to starve the people into opposition to their government. Mr. President, brothers and sisters, comrades, it is also necessary for us to say that this question of a closer union with Africa, between Africans, or within Africa, is not a purely academic question, despite the fact that this debate is occurring within the pinnacle of bourgeois academia. That there is a natural, historical inclination for Africa and African people to be united, which is one of the reasons I am here today. The truth of the matter is that this discussion about the unity of Africa, union of Africans, started much earlier than any incursion, as it might be characterized, of China or the Trump administration into Africa. The reality is that Africa came under assault some 600 years ago when Portugal first came and captured African people and initiated the process that would begin capitalism and would establish and consolidate the identity of Europeans in the world. It is a reality that capitalism rests upon a foundation of African slavery. Africans were first capital. And in order for this to occur and to last, it was absolutely necessary to keep African people divided so that we could not resist this horrible incursion on Africa that continues up to now. I think it's important to be able to say that. I think that we have to say that we've seen example after example by African people to unite. We've seen what used to be warring tribes in this geographical terrain that we occupy at this moment, able to achieve a sense of sameness that people refer to as nations, founded on a common economy that came from slavery and colonialism. This is the basis of the unity that we see. If there is a problem with the European Union today, it is because the foundation, the economic foundation of capital, of imperialism, is being stressed by the struggles of the oppressed peoples of the world to take back their resources from this parasite that bleeds Africa, that bleeds the world, that bleeds Afghanistan, that bleeds the people of Yemen who are dying by the thousands even as we have this discussion. This is the basis of a Brexit. It can't stand together anymore because the host is rejecting the parasite. And it's creating crisis throughout Europe and throughout the imperialist world. I think it's necessary, brothers and sisters, to say that there has been a natural trajectory by African people for closer union. We know that we're talking about having this discussion in part because in 1884-85, Europeans sat at a table in Berlin, Germany, not a single African there, and carved up Africa into the territories that we now sometimes call countries and illogically refer to as nations. Africans didn't do that. It was Europe that did that. It was Europe and imperialism that required Africa to be divided so that the resources of Africa, both human and material, could come and pave the streets in London and grow the buildings in Amsterdam and bring clean water to New York, while the streets in Sierra Leone are not paved. And the people in Sierra Leone do not have clean water. And there's no national electric grid there. It is necessary to keep Africa divided by European imperialism and by all the imperialism in order to continue to suck the resources from Africa so that cell phones could exist here, so that Steve Jobs and the others could achieve some great notoriety from the coltan that comes from Congo, where Leopold killed at least 12 to 15 million Africans in order to conquer and keep Africa in the condition it's in today. We talk about a united Africa, an African Union, because of what European imperialism has done to Africa to keep us divided. We know it's true. We saw 100 years or so ago, Marcus Garvey organized the Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities Leagues that stretched across the globe. More than 11 million African people everywhere were connected to this. Africa for Africans at home and abroad. That was the cry. Not Africans for Nigerians that didn't even exist until the British created in 1915. And Flora Shaw, the mistress who would become the wife of Frederick Lugard, came up with the name Nigger Area. Not this false national consciousness that has been imposed on Africans around the world, so that when the Portuguese found shrimp on West Africa and then named it for the Portuguese word for shrimp, Cameroon, it is not true that they are shrimp despite the fact that the people call themselves Cameroonians today. It is a false national consciousness. The false national consciousness that created the American Negro, that created the Black Brit, the Afro-Swede. We are one Africa, one nation, and we must have closer union. But in order for that to happen, it has to be a revolutionary union. The Organization of African Union created on May 25th, 1963 in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, was part of an effort to circumvent efforts by Kwame Nkrumah to build a single union of African states. And instead, we come up with an organization of African Union that codified the colonial borders that were created by Europe in 1884 and 85. We have to be able to break out of this, but it's going to take revolution in order to do this. African revolution in order to do this. African revolution that will destroy imperialism and the world economy that's responsible for the growing immiseration of the masses of people around the world. Uhuru.
Passionate, to say the least. There's your bit of education, at least one bit of education for today. Folks, there's certain things that are just so painful to listen to, but we need to come to grips with reality. A couple of comments here on the social media. Pele says, George, would you believe I started looking at this video about 7 minutes ago? Yeah, great minds think alike, Pele. Anthony Park says, I wish we can put this speech into the context of our own country and region. Pilgrims, let's take another little break here. Then we'll come back with Mr. Anthony DeRiggs and the Carenage. Yesterday, or whenever, I think it was yesterday, we ran peace with Anthony. And a lot of you were struck by the fond memories that he evoked. Well, he's about to do the same this morning, this time about the Carenage. Hang in there.
Are you equipped to take a closer look behind the numbers? The Caribbean Institute of Forensic Accounting can help you build your professional skills to audit and investigate fraud, waste, and abuse. Through the Forensic Certified Public Accountants FCPA program, you gain qualification to conduct forensic audits and investigations globally. Earn international recognition and designation as a Forensic Certified Public Accountant from the Forensic CPA Society of the USA. Certificate courses run May to November 2019 in Grenada at the Grenada National Stadium. To register, contact us at info@cifa-edu.com or 868-224-3478.
I'm always on the move. Training, traveling, competing. So it's good to know I have Quad Bank in the palm of my hand.
Introducing e-banking, one of many customer convenience services from Grenada Cooperative Bank. And there's more to come.
It's swift, simple, and secure.
Welcome home.
Juve chocolates, cocoa nibs, and cocoa balls from Diamond Estate Grenada are now available at Amazon.com, Amazon.ca, Amazon.co.uk, and GrenadaMarket.com. Try the sensational touch of nutmeg and a touch of ginger chocolates. 75% dark and rich, 100% pure cocoa, and their 60% dark and sweet chocolate bars today. Amazon Prime members enjoy free shipping on these orders in the USA, Canada, and Europe. GrenadaMarket.com. When you can't come to the island, the products of the island will come to you.
That Carenage picture that you see right here. I stared at a picture of the Carenage and I was suddenly gripped with nostalgia. As I looked at the awe-inspiring horseshoe-shaped geographical scene, I was ushered back in time. The Carenage, forever beckoning, ignited thoughts I had long forgotten. I was taken back to the time when the Carenage, also known as the Wharf, was the venue of the event Prime Minister Gerry put on called Easter Water Parade. I thought of the huge crowds that jammed the area, to witness or take part in the entertainment. I pictured Gary and his political campaign from a wooden vessel in the placid waters close to Empire Cinema. I remember the sand that was brought from Grandin's Beach lined the water's edge. Yes, the Carenage had its own beach during the Easter Water Parade. The stevedores who assembled at the Seamen and Waterfront Workers Union, the building, they looked on in amazement and wondered what other strange ideas Gary had in mind. The carnival spectacle on the Carenage came to mind. The wonderfully clad masqueraders used to prance on the Carenage on the road, much to the delight of the cheering crowds. Well, they still do. The carnival Tuesday night, last lap jump up, was an especially thrilling affair. I visualized the famous Angel Harp steel band livening up the area with its scintillating song. It belted out the catchy tunes while Mafu and Tito's energetically pushed the stands. Those stands accommodated basemen who pounded relentlessly on the steel drums and sent feet jumping high. There was always an air of urgency on Carnival Tuesday night, as the revelers knew that midnight marked the end of their fun. The jam session picked up as the pace increased and the hour of midnight approached. I remember the restaurants. The Carenage was always a perfect setting for restaurants. Nutmeg, Rudolph, Portofino, and other restaurants. Rudolph provided the perfect atmosphere for dining and for absorbing the wonderful scenery the Carenage presented. One could nibble on a chicken snack and behold the rushing waves made by the massive ships as they propelled out of the Carenage harbor. Nutmeg Bar and Restaurant was the ideal spot to eat and to relax. One could sip on a glass of sea moss or a caribbean and be soothed by the beautiful sights around, or just recline on a chair and read a book from the nearby Sea Change bookstore. The atmosphere at the Nutmeg was always enchanting. And reflecting on the Carenage, the image of boats came to my mind. The Rum Runner was one such boat, still in operation. Fun-loving people joyfully boarded the Rum Runner when the sun went down or during the day to enjoy a wonderful offshore cruise. The sound of soca music from the Rum Runner always disturbed the quietness as it moved out. Tourists and Grenadians who came home on holiday always spoke of the marvelous time they experienced on the Rum Runner. The visitors used to stand still on the upper deck and breathe in the fresh Carenage air. They sucked in the air, and in the process, rejuvenated lungs long deprived of purity in the toxic environment of Toronto, New York, and London. I recall the greyish wooden boats known as lighters that idled on the calm waters of the Carenage. They were also the large wooden vessels that journeyed between Grenada and its sister isle, Caraco. With each trip, the boats heightened the bond between the two islands. The carnage had its various forms of entertainment. People flocked to the carnage Empire Cinema to see the movies. Even on Saturday, there was a matinee that drew a large crowd. The Cubbyhole was a popular dance spot and a good place to bust a lime. Who remembers Pebbles, a soul ice cream? And then there was a fella called Gooby, teller of tall tales. He used to pull crowds as he told his far-fetched stories on the sidewalk of the carnage or near Empire Cinema. He spoke of pulling cane from cane trucks and succeeding in pulling the whole truck. He recalled stories of Hurricane Janet and of parting fights in the sea between barracudas and sharks. Gooby was the comic relief for the citizens of the carnage. The carnage ghetto. I also remembered, I thought of the Rasta men reeling from the grassy high as they smoked their weed in the narrow corridors. I pictured them with the flying dreadlocks, dipping themselves in the water of the carnage to cool off. There are other memories of the carnage. The smell still lingers, engraved somewhere in my brain. Oh yes, the smell. There was the unmistakable smell of tobacco from the tourists mixed with the scent of fish from the small fishing boats that docked near the bigger boats. The carnage of the spot where firemen breezed out and waited for the next fire. And when there was a fire, they rode to it in their fire engines and fiercely fought the fire until the building was reduced to ashes. Then they headed back to the firehouse on the carnage to play dominoes and to wait for the next building to erupt in flames. So I looked at the picture, and the memories hit me like an avalanche. I pictured the huge political demonstrations that took place on the carnage. And you know what? I even saw myself buying a hot leavened bread and butter from Mr. Bruffett's shop and a quarter pound of salami from Tony in that small shop on the carnage. The taste is still in my mouth. I remember the carnage. Anthony Wendell the Riggs telling me story. God bless.
Thank you very much, Anthony, for once again helping us to relive very fond memories of days gone by. Program's just about time to pull the curtain down, but one more quick little break here, and we'll come back with our inspirational words for today.
Are you equipped to take a closer look behind the numbers? The Caribbean Institute of Forensic Accounting can help you build your professional skills to audit and investigate fraud, waste, and abuse. Through the Forensic Certified Public Accountants FCPA program, you gain qualification to conduct forensic audits and investigations globally. Earn international recognition and designation as a Forensic Certified Public Accountant from the Forensic CPA Society of the USA. Certificate courses run May to November 2019 in Grenada at the Grenada National Stadium. To register, contact us at info@cifa-edu.com or 868-224-3478.
Our parting word for today comes to you from the book of Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 to 7. As you listen to this, try and see if you recognize any similarities with the way things are today. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. So you must be careful to do everything they tell you, but do not do what they do, for they do not practice what they preach. They tie up heavy, cumbersome loads and put them on other people's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do is done for people to see. They make their phylacteries wide and their tassels on their garments long. They love the place of honor at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogues. They love to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to be called rabbi by others." See any similarities? Matthew 23, 1 to 7. On that note, pilgrims, Georgie Porgy is gonna mosey on out of here. Well, thanks for joining us for the Thursday edition. One more to go. And then, of course, Sunday morning, Sundays with George Grant. God bless you, folks.